Hasid gets lost in the forest. Mind you, we're not talking about a little bit of woodland here and there, but about the forest of Eastern Europe where full armies get lost. So the poor man walks along different paths for 3 days and three nights. And when he's close to desperation, he runs into no other than the Baal Shem Tov, the great Hasidic master. Rabbi, he says, praise be God, I'm so happy to have found you. I'm lost in this forest and I don't know how to get out. Maybe you can show me. Well, says the Baal Shem Tov, I'm lost too. Oh no, cries the Hasid, but wait, says the Baal Shem Tov. You know that the road you've taken leads nowhere, and I know that the road I took leads nowhere. So now we can look together for a new road. During this past year, we've been all a little bit like that Hasid in the forest, lost in an unknown world, in a maze of new threats and unprecedented challenges. And how many times we've waited in vain for somebody to show us the way out. We were all lost, and we still are. But our common perplexity, our shared perplexity, is maybe our salvation. In one of our recent podcast episodes, Israeli behavioral scientist Dan Ariely told me a very interesting story about a small town in Belgium called Giessenheim. In 2004, a gas pipe exploded in the town center. It killed 24 people, and it severely injured 150. Years later, researchers went back to the town to study the long-term effect of trauma. They compared the victims of Giessenheim with the victims of other disasters, notably with a bombing of a train station in a Dutch city. What they found surprised them. The Belgians had much less of what we call post-traumatic stress disorder, and in fact, exhibited a healthy dose of post-traumatic growth. It was surprising because compared to the Dutch explosion, the Belgian one was more devastating and deadly. So what was the difference between them? Belgium and the Netherlands are very similar, so we can adjudicate that to cultural difference or ethnic difference. The economy even is very similar. So what was the difference? Here's what they found. Giessenheim is a small town, and the disaster was felt and experienced by the entire town together. A train station, however, is by definition a place of passage. Nobody belongs there. In a word, what Giessenheim had that guaranteed its resilience was a community. So you see why in our virtual conference, we connected the elements of resilience, humility, and community. Community makes us resilient. Humility allows us to recognize that we are lost and reach out to others so as to build together a better future. Collective resilience needs a community, and a community of purpose needs humility. There are many words that became en vogue during the pandemic. Pivot, one that I hate, but is one of the most notable. Unprecedented is one of the words of the year. I learned actually this week that maskne, a skin irritation caused by the mask, is also trending. But resilience is maybe the most important. Resilience is a curious word. It was first used in the 1620s by Francis Bacon, and it comes from the word resiliere, which means to jump back or to rebound. So Bacon used it to describe an element that has been subjected to a stressor, heat or cold, and then it has the property to go back to its original state. Now, I, for one, am not really hoping that we will experience a Baconian resilience. I would love us to see a resilience of transformation, a renaissance. I don't want us to simply go back to the status quo ante, but create something new out of the crucible of this crisis. So how do we create this renaissance? And what can we as funders do about it? I think that there are three key elements, and we choose to structure this conference around them. As we saw, community, doing this together. This is the first key element. Simply put, the strength and the quality of our recovery will be directly proportional to the strength of our community. Now, this pandemic did not catch us in a great moment in terms of community cohesion. We, like very much of the world, are living in highly polarized times in which opponents are seen as enemies, and those that disagree are perceived not just as different, but as dangerous. It's also a time in which communities are reckoning with the long-delayed issues of racial justice and inclusion in general. So it's a tough time for communities. But I don't think that polarization is in itself the problem. After all, having strong opinions is not a bad thing. Rather, the problem is an unwillingness to accept diversity and to respect those with whom we disagree. The problem is seeing them as evil and as outside of our shared destiny. In other words, the main difference today is not between left or right, orthodox or reform, progressive or conservative, Israeli or diasporic, hawks and doves, religious and secular. The main difference today is between those who accept and embrace the complexity of the community and those who don't. Those who see that despite our difference, all Jews around the world are inextricably linked in a collective project, and those who gladly see us drift apart. So, as funders, we need to do something that may be counterintuitive and countercultural. We need to fund and nurture diverse spaces. We need to double down on programs that create bridges and a shared language, spaces that can be the public square of the Jewish community. Sometimes we may need to fund things that we don't fully agree with. We may be tempted, for example, to cut funding to a JCC that hosts a program with which we disagree ideologically, but that JCC serves as a communal public square. And that will, by definition, include things that we won't like. We may be tempted, for example, to fund only media outlets that reflect our views, but that kind of outlet wouldn't be a true venue for communal dialogue, but an echo chamber. This is not about creating kumbaya moments. It's not about suppressing difference. Rather, the opposite. It's about understanding that a community, any community, is not as it wanted to be, but as it is. And it's also about understanding that the very concept of community in these times of virtual reality and social media merits a reevaluation. It is up to us funders to help create the new face of community. The second key element for resilience, this resilience plus that I'm advocating for, is humility. Now, humility in this context is not just a good character trait. Rather, it's about understanding that in unprecedented times, we are all like that Hasid in the forest. We don't really know. There are no oracles. We need to be smart together, and for that, we need to assume that none of us has all the answers. Intellectual humility allows us to build spaces of cognitive diversity, and that diversity is key for finding creative solutions to unprecedented complex problems. We can't generate great collective ideas if we believe only our own thoughts are worthy of consideration. Without humility, it is impossible to empower others, to let them display all their capacity. Without humility, it is impossible to learn from our history, to be lovingly self-critical and learn from our mistakes. Not in vain, humility is a key Jewish value. The Bible, said the late Rabbi Jonathan Sacks, is an anthology of self-criticism. It's all about what leaders and the people do wrong and how they grow from it. So how can we as funders help create a culture of humility in our communities? The answer is obvious. It starts with ourselves. Funders are in a position of relative power, so humility needs to be a conscious and deliberate effort, a habit that takes root by repetition and practice. There are ways in which we can make our grant making, for example, better and humbler. We can encourage and reward honest feedback from our grantees. We can engage the communities we serve in our grant making, and we can involve people with lived experiences and uphold viewpoint diversity, not only in our boardrooms, but also in our portfolio of grantees. Humility does not mean weakness, rather the opposite. It demands a strong sense of security, a strong sense of self, to know what we stand for. Humility doesn't preclude decisive action, because decisiveness and thoughtfulness are not opposed. In fact, the type of humility we need to practice is an empowered humility. And that takes us to the last key element of resilience. One we would have devoted a day to had this conference had been 4 instead of 3 days long. And that element is courage. Without the courage to try new things, to imagine a different future, to take risks, we are at best stuck in a Bacon-like resilience, just trying to go back to how things were before. But it's impossible to go back to the past. The past is gone, and that past was not ideal either. So the success of the Jewish people always consisted in creating new things after a disaster, of taking the best of the past and letting go of the rest. After the destruction of the temple, for example, we created Rabbinical Judaism, a radical new idea that both renewed and preserved Judaism. After World War II, we established the modern state of Israel. And although the lion's share of the groundwork had been laid in the decades before the war, that creation was fundamentally new and yet linked to 3,000 years of history. The crisis we face today is an opportunity for bold action, for courageous reimagining, for recreating our communal structures in ways that are more adequate and relevant to our times. Our community system is precious, but it's also the product of a very specific set of historical circumstances. These circumstances have now changed. So, what can funders do to demonstrate and build courage? First, we can incentivize and reward risk-taking. We can direct more grant-making to structural reform and be open to think at every turn, what is the community that we need now, instead of letting inertia guide us? We have some great examples of that type of giving during the pandemic. The work of the Jewish Communal Response Impact Fund, the Capacity Collaborative of the Jewish Federation of Chicago, the work of the Harold Greenspun Foundation and the Foundation for Jewish Camp. Those are great examples, but more are needed. Finally, we need courage to stand for our values, especially in times of great moral cowardice like ours. We talked about community, but a community is not just a gathering of people. It needs a purpose, a mission, a set of values to uphold. Lately, we seem to have lost that. The Jewish people sometimes look, as Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel said, like a messenger without a message. My friends, these are not easy times, and this is not an easy task. But we at JFN are here to help, to be the platform for open conversation, for free exchange of ideas, and for learning from one another. We are the place where we can share our perplexity and our disorientation without being judged. This is the community in which we can exercise humility and courage. The incredible and record-breaking participation of our members in the JFN programs that we did during the pandemic shows that funders are eager to both listen and roll up their sleeves. And that fills me with great optimism and hope. During this crisis, the philanthropic community stepped up like never before. 72% of our members, 72, increased their giving during the pandemic. 57% plan to keep a higher level of giving in the year ahead. Over half of us funded in different areas than the usual ones in order to respond better to the crisis. That gives us an amazing base upon which to build. A couple of examples of things that we at JFN are doing to bring these values of community, resilience, humility, and courage into practice. One, to strengthen our community of funders, we're doubling down on our work of peer networks and affinity groups. We will create more communities of funders in different geographic regions, as we did in the West Coast and Canada. We will be making a special effort to engage individual funders and mid-sized funders, which represent the bulk of Jewish giving. To exercise the value of humility, we are, in partnership with Upstart, starting a program called Granted. It's a new set of resources and events for funders and grantees to better listen to one another and learn from one another. Three, we are helping funders who have the courage to dream, to imagine new community structures and new priorities, like the members of our National Affinity Group on Jewish Poverty, or Canvas, our funders collaborative on arts and culture, that is thinking out of the box how to rebuild that entire philanthropic field. We at JFN are here to help you. During this last year, I feel that JFN went from being a vitamin to a painkiller. But now we need to move past the mitigation into the challenging work of rebuilding. Based on these principles of resilience, but also on the timeless wisdom of our people. After all, the Jewish people has earned a PhD in resilience from the University of Human History. This, our meetings, our interactions during these 3 days and throughout the year, is like that clearing in the forest. That place where two lost Jews met and learned to find together a new way. We may be all lost, but we have the most important thing of all, each other.